called The Medicine Doll, Julia Inglis. She sent this over to Ireland, to the Forgotten Moors. The whole idea is that the energy in this tiny little doll with the two children above her head, and she's the mother. But you could go deeper into it when you think of Mother Nature and life givers. We were and are life givers. Life givers. We weren't seen as that. We weren't seen as expecting moms. We have these little booties, they're handmade porcelain. And again, another little lady here in Ireland who designed and made these and sent them to me when she heard about children. Catholic Church resigned and took girls in like me and, you know, cast aside their real identities. Put them into the places where you became non-human. Like my house name is Tracy, my number was 1725. I speak personally now. In 1973, I was trapped in this institution, but my whole society deemed me unfit to be a mother. This Roman Catholic Church were paid for my well-being, my food, my shelter, my medical care, none of which existed. So when I asked the government why are they not addressing how a company such as the Catholic Church could be allowed to commit blatant, you don't charge the government £1.05 a week for somebody's care and not give it, nor do you put the person in care to work. We work 12 hours a day. There's lots of maddening laundries in this country, known as laundries. Nobody looked at the mother and baby institutions that were also taken in the overflow of these laundries. Always work to be done, whether it was in the garden, laundry, the kitchen, and the stairs, you polish. You worked physically, non-stop. No medical care, no counselling, no respite, no nothing. And nobody stopped to question where all these girls were going. We vanished in thin air. I worked in London, I wasn't even in Ireland. I worked in Wood Green, North London, and I was taken out of London onto an airplane, and I arrived in a place called Cork and driven to a place called Besbury. And as soon as that door opened, that's when Terry was lost. We were very innocent, and the first thing they did was take a urine sample off of the syphilis. That was their priority. Not was the baby okay or you okay. Medically, that's the view they had of us. And we were dirty, filthy, and nobody would ever want us, and nobody would love us. And that's why we were there.
How did they communicate to you that you were dirty?
Sometimes they'd verbally say, you'll never be clean again, and, you know, no man will ever have you. I remember a nun turned around and saying to me when I was crying, she said, you know, to me, I don't know why you're crying. She said, you must know nobody loves you, nobody wants you. You wouldn't be in here if they did.
So they were deliberately cruel?
They were, yeah, they were. But then when I look back now, lots of nuns who were trapped in that institution, who were put in there by their parents, told they got a calling and they had a vocation. And they were going to serve God and marry God and do God's work for the rest of their lives. And where did they end up? In an institution looking after girls who were pregnant, girls who were giving birth, and girls who were screaming their halls down when they take their children from them.
So they were very frustrated?
Very, very.
With their own lives?
Yeah. It's like the battered wife syndrome, you know, and it spilled over. So we were at their beck and call. They had nobody else to take it out of them except us. Years later, I've heard of women who wear this habit say, oh, but we only did God's work and nobody else wanted us. And where would these girls be? Only for us. They'd be at the side of the road, blah, blah, blah. But the problem is, you have to realize that We had no internet, we had no mobile phones, it was nothing like that. But you had a service every Sunday, maybe 5 or 6 services in one day, where you had a guy in a white collar up on a pulpit looking down, dictating to people of the week. So he was serving his purpose of making a market for themselves by creating us as the recipients of that market. So therefore, the more we were shunned and the more we were thrown and hidden, and we were the prize that day, the more it was justifiable for them to take the child. You know what the one thing used to bother me most? Why would anybody want a child from me if I was such a bad person? And Maggie attached herself onto me. She was like a little girl still playing with her Barbie doll. And when the child kicked inside of her, sure, I had no idea either, I was 18. But she'd run to me and go, oh, you know, Tracy, 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 you know, like it was a big adventure. And she went hysterical when she went into labour, and you could hear the screams down the hallways, you know. And I got up to go down and see if they'd find her, because she was screaming my name all over the place. And the nun just ushered me and said, get back into your bed, you know, mind your business, we look after her. I never saw Maggie again, she wasn't anywhere to be seen the next day. The one thing that they did hold us on was a real grounded fear. If you didn't play ball, if you, you know, spoke back or fought back, you did know for certain that the doctors in local hospitals would come and inject you. And if you were lucky, you got to be sedated for a day till you behaved yourself, or you were never seen again. And there is places in like Lomans, Brennans, it just took one doctor to sign the paper and your life was over. And that happened to many a girl. When I went up to feed Niall on a Saturday morning, his clothes that I dressed him in that morning, I bathed him and fed him and put him to sleep. I went up to give him his next feed, and his baby grow is his vest, his 2 socks were just left at the end of his cot, his blanket. Everything that represented him and me was just piled there. He was gone. You know, I couldn't run out into the mountain road and scream the place down, somebody help, 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 my baby's been taken. Because a nun took him. She put him in a car and she drove back to Besbury where I escaped from because I was processed in their books so they would get paid for me. I think it was only about 6 years ago that I got a copy of the adoption certificate where they don't even have his name on it, where she'd go in and get them rubber stamped. You know, so a lot of donations and people helping, supporting the nuns with their good work. It's a nice way of saying we didn't buy a child or we didn't give you money for the child. You know, and the clergy get away with that because they're a charity, and donation after donation after donation is not seen as a purchase. Once our child left our bodies, we didn't exist anymore. They didn't even see us when we were carrying our babies.
So they just wanted to get their hands on the children
and
that were given birth to.
White babies.
In order to put them through their system that they had in behind the scenes.
And
commercially based.
And doctors, social workers, guards, barristers, judges, everybody was involved. So you can't just solely say it was the Catholic Church, because they couldn't have operated alone. They needed the law, they needed medical, they needed the social workers. It was all wrapped up in a nice parcel, an industry that was a racket that made a lot of people very rich.
And these very vulnerable and very young mothers, they were essentially nullified in their personality, nullified in their identity.
Yes.
In order for them to get to the children.
Yes. That's exactly what I've always said. Dehumanized. Your baby was taken off you
mm-hmm.
and put into a nursery. There's
mm-hmm.
2 or 3 nurseries. These children were locked away, newborn babies, away from their mummies.
So it was very engineered, very systemized.
Yeah. And then they'd say it's for your own good.
And then the mothers then would become a threat.
Would have been offered a ticket to go to England, get the boat, get out of Ireland, shame on you. You know, don't let anybody know you were ever here.
So fear was instilled into
them. Always fear, yeah.
And an indirect threat not to follow up on where their child went.
Oh, if you're told, if you ever try and find your child, the police will arrest you.
Why? Why would the police arrest you?
Because your child belonged to the couple who was being adopted by.
How did they get to the mothers to convince them that their child didn't belong to them?
Brainwashing, conditioning. Think of somebody who goes into a cult. It takes a while. So by the time the baby is born, you really aren't human. And you are the last person in the world to try and keep that child. I can see now, in retrospect, what was going on. I can stand back now and look at the picture. But when I was partaking in the picture, I was a very vulnerable, frightened 18-year-old. I can channel my anger through that as well.
People that were involved in this?
No. No. That's between them and their God. But the one nun, Sister Paula, took him. I've often dreamed about meeting her in a room, face to face. She'll have convinced herself that she did the right thing for Niall. Because that was one thing the nuns would say to you. Don't be selfish. You have nothing to give this child. Absolutely nothing. Do not deprive this child of what they deserve. A good home, a Catholic mummy and daddy. How dare you be so selfish? That's what I got. I read in one of my reports, I am so glad that she has gone. She was definitely a very difficult girl to deal with. My difficulty was I would never sign a page. With this exhibition, there's hope that from young people. But the one thing I do hope for is just for transparency of truth. Nobody can change the past. Nobody can undo what was done. But we can make a difference by allowing ourselves to say things happened in the past. They weren't good things. They were bad. They were difficult, but they happened. And I think if that's allowed to be out in the open, it's more normal and natural. We deal with no more secrets in our lives.
And that's exactly what Anna's doing with this exhibition.
The exposure of being allowed to say, look, this is part of our history. This is who we are. I wouldn't be the person I am today if stuff that happened to me hadn't happened. If I hadn't lost my son, my son had been taken out of his car, I would not be the person I am now. I know that.
And when you feel that, we need to have a really thorough, healthy conversation about this as our past in order to go forward in the future.
Open it up.
And that's what this exhibition is all about.
Open.
Forbearance and neighbourly love. The cause of our tradition.